Fresh meat. Today I'd like to dig into a couple things that don't get a lot of discussion. The evil genie, or Djinn. no, but that is the devil's water. And of course, director Jack Sholder. First and foremost, the Djinn subgenre. I mean, we don't get a heck of a lot of these floating around. Looking at the main entries, you have stuff like The Outing from 87, and the great Toby Hooper's final directorial effort, The Djinn from 2013. Other than that, you have to mine the foreign markets to find anything major. That is, except for Wishmaster. Now, Wishmaster from 1997 is not a black sheep. I mean, if anything, it belongs in our other show, the best horror movie you never saw, of course, for the younger crowd. And looking at the cast, this is kind of the proto-Expendables of horror. You have Tom Savini in an uncredited role, Tony Todd, Kane Hodder, Reggie Bannister, Buck Flower, Joe Pilato, Ted Raimi, Robert Englund, and Angus Scrimm.
Once in a time before time, God breathed life into the universe.
All filling various roles from the big to the small. And that's not even mentioning that the movie comes with the old-fashioned presented by, with none other than Wes Craven doing the presenting. Now, of course, Wes Craven didn't have anything to do with this, as it was just a way to drum up more sales. Now, the writer was the guy who wrote the first three Hellraiser sequels, and the director was longtime special effects master Robert Kurtzman. Was only directing his second film, with his first being The Demolitionist from 95. Yeah, another unseen gem. Now, the movie is actually offered to Jack Sholder, but he turned it down, and we'll get to him more in a bit. Wishmaster is a fun, special effects heavy original tale that really only suffers because its later sequels went off the deep end, and that Divoff quit after two movies. But today's not about Wishmaster. No. Today is about Wishmaster 2, Evil Never Dies. Now, the movie loses everyone that had to do with the first, except for the great Andrew Divoff.
Andrew, I don't know how to say your last name, I apologize. Divoff.
Who returns to play the Djinn once again. And honestly, his glee and scenery chewing are some of the best parts of this movie. Let's be honest, when you go to see a Wishmaster flick, you gotta see Divoff.
Yo, man, are you tripping? Who the fuck are you?
I'm the Wishmaster.
I make wishes come true.
He owns every bit of dialogue and every bit of body language. The movie opens up with a botched museum robbery. Now, see, the Djinn takes a human form by the name of Demarest, which I'll refer to him from here on out, and is captured by police at the museum, but not before freezing a cop after he says, and you guessed it,
freeze!
Did I hear you say freeze?
Yeah.
Wishmaster 2 follows a similar tone and pattern for much of the rest of the movie. Morgana almost always seems to be in her underwear in bed, dreams of Demarest and the terror he is causing, and that Demarest, now in prison, works his way through the prisoners, granting wishes and taking souls. You see, souls are what he needs to grow stronger, and that, combined with granting three wishes to Morgana, who accidentally freed him, will allow his fellow Djinn to inherit the earth. These wish-granting segments are often the most entertaining parts of the film, and the fact that the Wishmaster sequel is pretty much some studio head at a conference table being like, hey, what if it's the Djinn meets Ernest Goes to Jail?
Know what I mean?
The first instance in jail is when a fellow inmate asks to walk through the bars, and Demarest complies by absolutely destroying the guy with his body, bones, and all. One of the other standouts early on is one of the most ridiculous things I've ever seen. One inmate tells Demarest that he wishes his lawyer would go f*** himself, as he isn't doing enough to help him get out of jail. Now, the very next scene, we see the inmate and the lawyer together, who happens to have found evidence that'll help clear his name. Now, if this was an episode of The Twilight Zone, the inmate would have made some sort of deal with the devil, and the kicker would have been his lawyer having a heart attack before being able to clear his name. The lawyer continues his discomfort before his entire lower body twists and cranks around, and takes care of business, just like the inmate wished for.
What about my case, man?
There it is, everybody. I think we're done, folks. You'll no longer have to watch cinema anymore, because you have seen the greatest thing put to the silver screen. And honestly, I won't hear any arguments. Okay, but we must continue. Wishmaster 2 switches back and forth between Demarest doing evil genie stuff in prison, and Morgana putting her dreams and research together to figure out what he is and how to stop him. She's aided by a priest who looks like he would be in either a soap opera or one of the 1,000 holiday films on Lifetime every year. The guy tries, but, Demarest runs out of souls in the prison and decides to escape with a Russian mobster named Osip, who not only believes he is an evil djinn, but wants to use his powers to help raise himself and his own criminal organization. Consequences be damned. Now, after getting his wish and taking over for his boss, Morrigana confronts him at the club and attempts to kill him. Demarest goes to reap more souls in a place that is easy pickings. You know it. Las Vegas. Morrigana is crushed that she was not able to defeat Demarest, even after completing a cleansing ritual that involved cutting off her own finger and losing her late 90s grunge angst style. The priest, Gregory, finds her crying and praying in the church only to tell her that God will help her defeat the evil. Well, you know, God and an incarnation from the man who imprisoned the genie into the gem in the first place. And let's not forget, some sweet, sweet lovemaking.
I really don't think this is the way to heaven.
Because the late 90s still understood the cinematic value of an unneeded sex scene. With Demarest in Las Vegas, the movie decides to throw one last set piece at you. In fact, one of the best scenes is when Morrigana and Gregory go to defeat the djinn, but politely knock on his door. And the djinn respectfully lets him in.
Come in.
His weird voice, sarcastic tone. I mean, honestly, this guy plays a better Randall Flagg than Skarsgård, I hate to say it. But when they both try to outwit him, Demarest pulls them into hell, where Gregory's tortured and killed, in kind of a cool crucifixion scene. But then he decides to take out the casino patrons in an attempt to get Morrigana to use her three wishes and fulfill the prophecy. We get a belated rogue roulette wheel and playing cards, razor sharp, slicing and dicing people left and right. Morrigana uses a wish to bring back the security guard who died while her and her boyfriend Corey Haim were robbing the museum. This act makes her pure, for reasons, and can now put him back in the gem and save the human race. Which brings us full circle to director Jack Sholder. He gave us this in A Nightmare on Elm Street 2, which I've always liked, Alone in the Dark, and 87's The Hidden. He looks back at Wishmaster 2 in a very realistic and pragmatic way. He loved how it looked on paper and when he was shooting it, but the finished product was admittedly kind of off. And Jack, the black sheep salutes you. Never change, sir. And yeah, Wishmaster 2 isn't perfect. It is a clear step down from the first. But when you think about it, I mean, this was a made-for-TV movie. It aired on HBO and then went straight to DVD. It didn't even have a theatrical run. Not to mention, it's literally half the budget of the first. In fact, I always kind of felt like this is a proper third entry. You know, the first two have a little more unique and outgoing story ideas, but by the third, it kind of just finds its own groove, gives you some cool kills, fun special effects, and a great lead. And by that, I mean Divoff. And if this was the series low and stayed at this point forever, I would have a great time. It almost has that sort of mid-entry Leprechaun feel. You see, Wishmaster 2 doesn't take itself too seriously.
Oh, please. Not that old story again. Hell is your world, not mine.
It knows what it has to offer and leans into that aspect hard. Andrew Divoff gives us the best damn djinn we can ask for. He chews scenery like he hasn't eaten in weeks and fully embraces his two-film run. A lot of the kills are fun and stupid, but still deliver on the blood and gore. Listen, grab a beer, smoke them if you got them, get a group of friends, and have a fun time. This sequel knows what it is and doesn't aim any higher. And you know what? Every now and then, it's what you need.
Case, man!
Hey, thanks for watching our show. Please subscribe to our JoBlo Horror Videos channel. Tell your friends who like this sort of content. And turn on the bell to receive notifications for all of our latest videos. Listen, we're an independent company, and we appreciate all of your support.